Well, hi guys, it's that time. It's our Bible teaching snippet of the day. Well, today I'd like to pick up and do part 8, which I hope will be my last part in this series. And by the time I get done with this, Holy Spirit may tell me to do something different. But as of right now, I believe I can wrap this up today and move on to some other teachings as well. This is part 8 of the series that I put a title to, and I called it The Authority and Priority of the Words of Jesus. And I want to start this particular teaching as a wrap-up and say this. And a lot of the things that I'm going to talk about today, I've already said in one way or another. I am not telling anyone to throw their Bibles away or to quit reading the Old Testament. What I'm trying to do is to have people rethink the way that they're reading the Bible as a whole, and let's go back and reconsider that we are supposed to be putting a higher priority on the words of Jesus when it comes to us knowing God the Father, okay? Jesus himself has said over and over again in the New Testament, as well as some of the New Testament writers, is that Jesus came and revealed in the fullness who the Father truly is, okay? No one in the Old Testament claimed that because we have a thing called progressive revelation. I'll talk a little more about that during this particular session. But what it is that the Old Testament people only had a limited understanding and revelation. They were laying a groundwork, a history that we can look back on, okay, to prove the origins of where Jesus came from, okay, starting all the way from Joseph to the Garden of Eden to Adam, right there in Luke's gospel. Then we also see, as well in Matthew's gospel, we can go from Jesus all the way back to what they would call Father Abraham. So see, all of that Old Testament gives us a history and an understanding of how God worked through man from the fall in Genesis to the birth of Jesus, and then Jesus comes to show us who the Father really is. And another limited revelation, or what we call, they have a limited understanding, but it's progressive revelation, is that in the Old Testament, we don't see the name Satan or the adversary mentioned but 18 times. And Jesus is continuously talking about the devil, the Satan, and unclean spirits, things that we just simply don't see a lot of in the Old Testament, right? So we need to look at the Old Testament. Yes, look, let me read this to you, okay? It says here that, and this is 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, and this is actually what it says in the Greek, okay? It says, every writing inspired by God is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for instructions in right living, living like God lives, that the man of God may be complete and thoroughly equipped for every good work. Now, what this scripture did not say, it is that the Old Testament or all scripture is profitable for knowing who God the Father really is. It didn't say that. It's saying that we can read the Old Testament and learn things from them. And I'm going to talk a little about that as well. What I want to work into this teaching today, and before I go any further, let me say this one more time. You know, in Matthew chapter 11, verse 27, Jesus is talking, okay? Hopefully we can hear him and hear what he says. He says, no one has known or fully understood my Father except me. And I am here to reveal to anyone willing to listen who my Father is. Okay, so notice Jesus didn't say that everybody in the Old Testament knows my Father really, really well, and I'm just going to come and put some flesh on and line up everything that's in the Old Testament for you. This is why Philip said, after being with Jesus, the disciples have been traveling with Jesus, seeing all of these wonderful things, seeing the love of God flow through Jesus. And Philip says, show us the Father. And Jesus says, do you not recognize me? You have spent all this time with me and you still don't understand? If you knew me, you would know my Father. Philip, if you have laid eyes on me, you have watched me, listened to me, walked with me, and you still don't understand and know who the Father is, I am showing you the Father by me being here. If you have seen me, you have seen my Father. And so let me say this. In John chapter 3, verse 34, Jesus, it's talking about Jesus here. It says, "For since he whom God has sent," talking about Jesus, "speaks the very words of God, he proclaims God's very own message. God does not give him," Jesus, "his spirit sparingly or by measure, but boundless is the gift of God makes of his spirit." So right here what we see is that God gave Jesus a fullness of his message so he could come and represent him in his fullest measure to all mankind. I'm going to read the footnote again in the disciples' literal New Testament. And down here it says, God does not give Jesus a measured manifestation of the spirit, comma, listen to this last part, as he does with all other prophets. See, in the past, God was given portions to mankind doing different prophecies about Jesus. Jesus said that all of the Torah, the prophets, and the law were pointing to him, that they were about him, okay? It did not say that it identified and correctly taught us who God the Father is. It is showing us that Jesus is going to be born and God will be manifested in the flesh. I pray that someone is getting a revelation out of what I'm teaching today. Okay, so what I want to cover real quick with the rest of my time here today with you is I want to talk about a thing that we call a doctrine in our churches, and it's called the infallibility and the inerrancy of the Bible. Now, many people think that this teaching is saying that I don't believe this, and I do believe that the Bible in its original manuscripts are free of error, okay, and they are incapable of leading people into error. That's what inerrancy means. Inerrant means there's no errors contained within it, okay? And the word infallible means not to be able to lead someone the wrong direction. It's error-free, and it says incapable of error in defining doctrines of faith, and that's one of the meanings of that word. But here's what we also have to understand, okay? Our different translations are not completely accurate. There have been words added, words picked out by the translators that aren't necessarily delivering the exact same message that was in the manuscripts, okay? And here's something else too, okay? Different books have been taken out of our Bibles, okay? So we have some things that are missing. Even in our scriptures that we have, like in the King James, and I'm going to do a teaching on this, there have been words added into scripture that was never in the original manuscripts. So in its original form, yes, the Bible is infallible and free of error. That being said, I want to talk a little bit to you about the doctrine that we hold. What this doctrine did not mean to do, but it has done over the short period of time it's been in the body of Christ, is to put the Bible and everything that's written in it at the same priority and giving it the same authority as the words of Jesus. And that, my friends, is not scriptural. I've read you in the last 7 episodes of this teaching where Jesus himself said that he was the authority of the Father and that his words were directly from the Father. No one else has ever claimed that in the Old Testament nor in the New Testament, but we apply that rule to them and they never ask us to do that. Did you know the Apostle Paul never said that every word that I say is equal to Jesus? No, he said that he was a man representing God. Jesus is the one that said, "I am the one that you can trust to be true. I am the way, the truth, the life, and I am the way to the Father." No one else has said that, guys. So that means we have to look at Jesus to know the Father. We cannot look at people who had partial revelations to know who our Father really is, okay? So let me say this. With the church never intended for us to try to twist and mix and push and pull and stuff it together to try to make the Bible seem like it has no contradictions, because quite honestly, it does have contradictions, because different people were writing things from a different revelation and perspective as time went in the Old Testament. Let me read this straight off my notes for time here. It says, where did the idea of inerrancy come from? This doctrine causes a irreconcilable dualism of the Old Testament God and the New Testament Jesus. And this came, this doctrine was first put in place by the Second Vatican Council in 1965, is when this doctrine came along, okay? And then later, in 1978, the Chicago Doctrine of Inerrancy was published. Okay, so that tells you where that came from and how long it's been in our churches. Now, what I want to talk about from here, basically, is to tell you that the Doctrine of Inerrancy was never intended to assign all of the Bible, like the Old Testament, with the same authority as Jesus. It was saying that Scripture was actually recorded accurately so that we could read it and know that what was written was a true account of what was going on at the time. Now, from here, what I want to do is I want to show you, just real quick before I close out today, we do have contradictions in the Old Testament as well as all the way through the New Testament. This is just one example because I want to bring this together and show you what I'm talking about. In 2 Samuel chapter 24, as well as in 1 Chronicles 21. Both of these accounts are of King David counting the people. 2 Samuel says that God himself moved David, but then God gets mad at David for counting them, right? But then later we see that Ezra says in 1 Chronicles chapter 21 that Satan stood up against Israel and he provoked David to count the people. Now, what's interesting is this word God moved, M-O-V-E-D, David in 2 Samuel is the exact same word in the Hebrew and as it is in 1 Chronicles 21 that Ezra used that says that Satan provoked David. That word moved and provoked is the exact same Hebrew word. What did I just show you? That the Bible is actually inerrant. And it is absolutely correct in what it's trying to say, that David was being pushed to do something. But what we see is one man who's writing does not have a revelation that there is a Satan, so he thinks that God made David do that. But later, when Ezra writes, he clears it up and says, no, see, Satan stood up against Israel, and he's the one that provoked David to count the people. I pray that this is making sense to you. And how do we know that Ezra is the one who got it right? I'm going to tell you, because over here we see in Scripture, it is in James, I believe it's like chapter, here it is, I've got it marked, James chapter 1, verse 13. It says here, when people are tempted or undergoing a trial, they should not say that God is tempting them. Did you get that? So see, we have a New Testament verse that clears up and settles what two different people believed at the time, right? And of course, I've got another scripture down here. James keeps talking, and it's verse 17. James chapter 1, verse 17. And he says, every good action and every perfect gift is from God. These gifts come down from heaven, from the Creator of the sun, moon, and stars, and who does not change like the shifting of shadows. Now, the footnote, real quick, I believe it says here, this is an implication that there is nothing that you will find wrong with God, nothing in Him that could ever remotely appear to be evil hiding within Him. The more you get to know God, the more you realize how beautiful and holy He is. So, do you see what I'm saying? The Bible has a place, but we have to approach Scripture differently when we're looking at what Jesus says as to what the Old Testament people thought they knew at the time. Listen, I'm out of time today, guys, and I pray that this teaching has come together and made you understand. Let's look at Jesus so that we will know the Father. okay, and use the rest of the Old Testament and writings back then to understand it's our history and the foretelling of our Savior. I love you. Bye-bye.